gather for a celebration. Coming to this country's golden shores, to New York Harbor, to honor one of liberty's proudest symbols, the Statue of Liberty.
Tonight it begins as ABC presents Liberty Weekend. Dark for the past 2 years, the Lady's Torch will be relighted by the President, while in cities and towns around the nation, 20,000 new American citizens will be sworn in. Then the entertainment begins. Frank Sinatra, Shirley MacLaine, Neil Diamond, Gregory Peck, Elizabeth Taylor, Debbie Allen, Mikhail Baryshnikov, and more as the salute to Lady Liberty starts with a gala opening ceremonies. Now from Governor's Island, Peter Jennings and Barbara Walters.
From Governor's Island, in fact, on the edge of this magnificent harbor, the upper bay of New York Harbor, with the ships from the international fleet already here and waiting to pay tribute tomorrow to the Statue of Liberty. And just having arrived a few moments ago on the east side, the Brooklyn side of Governor's Channel, on the golf course for this Governor's Island Coast Guard Station, President and Mrs. Reagan, the President now receiving honors. As here in the very small, recently constructed stadium, people begin to gather for what we can assure you, having had a sneak look at the preview last night, a very exciting set of opening ceremonies as we here on the East Coast, hopefully for you all across the country, wear patriotism on our sleeve. Barbara, good evening.
Good evening. I think it's going to be a very exciting night. You will be moved, I think. You will be entertained. You will be touched. Most of all, I think we're all going to feel very, very proud. Don't you?
I think we are, if we don't get blown away.
Yeah,
I must tell you, yesterday we were worried about the rain. There's something of a stiff gale blowing here this evening, which was very helpful to the tall ships as they're made their way down the East River today and then out to their berth where they're spending the night before they come up the harbor tomorrow. They tell us, Barbara, this will go down when the sun goes down, but I have my doubts.
Well, behind us is the stage, so they're going to be dancing and blowing, and it should be, as we said, interesting to watch.
And now that you mention the stage, let us give you some specific idea of exactly where we are. As Barbara said, there is the stage on which at the moment the U.S. Navy Band is playing for the crowd assembling, and it is there, of course, where the opening ceremonies will take place this evening. Just about 1,700 yards across this upper bay from the stage, you can see her, the Statue of Liberty, about to be relit by President Reagan in a couple of stages in all of her new glory. And not too far from Liberty Island, just a short way across the bay, Ellis Island, the old island of tears through which so many million of immigrants have passed on their way to life in the new world. And waiting there this evening, some 300 people, part of a group of 25,000 around the country, waiting to be sworn in as American citizens by Chief Justice Warren Burger, and that'll be part of the opening ceremonies. In effect, Ellis Island becomes a federal court just for tonight. And of course, there is the harbor, without the tall ships now, but with the International Naval Armada already berthed and ready to settle down for the night and for the long Liberty Weekend. Pleasure ships from all over the place, warships from 23 nations, poised, as we said, to come under, there it is, the Verrazano Narrows Bridge, which divides the upper and lower bays, so named for the first European who set eyes on this, one of the world's great harbors.
Last night, there was a dress rehearsal, and the Coast Guard, who inhabit this island, had a free, wonderful show. Well, that's not the case tonight. It will be a wonderful show, but it sure isn't free. It's costing the people here tonight $10,000 for a pair of tickets. Some of the people who are coming are as famous as the people on stage. Pierre Salinger has been mingling with the rich and famous, and brings us this report. Pierre?
To get on this boat tonight and head for Governor's Island, you need two important assets. Be rich or famous, and be willing to pay $5,000 for the right to join President Reagan and French President Mitterrand at the opening ceremony of Liberty Weekend. 12 minutes later, you've arrived, and a long red carpet is spread out to welcome you. Among the first arrivals were two of tonight's special honorees.
Good to see you.
How does it feel to be here?
Pretty nice. Pretty. This isn't one of my regular stops, you know.
I remember when I came up this harbor as an immigrant on the Ile de France. And it's quite an exciting experience.
From there, it was a brief sunny walk to the party.
Good, how are you? Nice.
Once there, an Air Force orchestra set the soft tone. The food was lavish, salmon, chicken, and roast beef. The bar is poised to serve everything from diet cola to fine wines. Lee Iacocca, the man who launched all this, was proud of the American contributions to make this weekend possible.
The American people came through at 277, probably going for 300 million, so in a short time, that's just spectacular, and the American public's generous.
New York Governor Mario Cuomo had deep reflections on his Italian past.
I think the more I reflect on it, the idea that we should be lucky enough to have had our parents come here and us be born here, I think it's very important that we keep the perspective on it. We're going to be rejoicing our good luck, and that's fine. But we ought to remember that not everybody shares it.
But maybe the most enthusiastic participant at the party was the former Israeli, now American concert violinist, Itzhak Perlman.
My wife called me up and she says, guess what? They're giving this to you. And I said, what? You know, and eventually it became evident that it's probably the biggest honor I'll ever received. You know? So.
What do you think of your... But in the end, whether you were rich or famous, you ended up having to go through a tough security test before you went to tonight's celebration. Wary police dogs watched them all walk in. $1,000 may seem like a lot of money for an evening's entertainment, but tonight is very special in America's history, and the people who are here will never forget this evening when they will see the reborn Statue of Liberty lit up again. Peter?
Thank you, Pierre Salinger here on Governor's Island. As Itzhak Perlman made an allusion to it, we'll tell you that part of the opening ceremonies this evening will be devoted to the presentation of the Liberty Medal by President Reagan to 12 naturalized Americans, and Itzhak Perlman will indeed be one of them. There we look now down at the stage for the opening ceremonies. People gathering now very quickly with President Reagan on the island. We're not too far from the beginning of what surely is going to be one of the great entertainment and certainly moving, and as Pierre Salinger suggested, historic shows. We are here to celebrate the 100th anniversary of the Statue of Liberty. President Mitterrand will be coming along shortly. So will Mikhail Baryshnikov and the others. We'll be back.
ABC's presentation of Liberty Weekend is brought to you by Celebration of 100 Years of Beauty, Dodge, a performance revolution and an American revolution, and IBM.
The sun is just clinging to the horizon now, and there from high on the pylons of the Verrazano Narrows Bridge, which links Brooklyn with Staten Island in New York Harbor, the view of Lower Manhattan, Governor's Island, and a portion of the Armada, which has gathered all across this harbor and up and down the Hudson River to begin the celebrations of Liberty Weekend. We hope that in the next few days, you across the country, those of you more landlocked than we are at the moment, will feel as much affection towards this harbor and its place in American history as we have in the last few visits we've paid in preparation for this evening. Barbara?
As Pierre pointed out, Peter, there are a lot of celebrities here tonight watching the show and in the show. One of them is Gregory Peck. He will be the first host, and he will introduce President Mitterrand. I talked with him a few moments ago as he was getting ready. Mr. Peck, does the Statue of Liberty have special meaning to you?
It does. I think it's quite a typical story, but mine is about my grandmother, who was a bold young Irish girl from a poor farm in County Kerry in the south of Ireland. And she came over steerage in 1886, not long after the statue was first dedicated. And when I was a very small boy, I liked to hear her tell that story of how they arrived in New York Harbor, and all the steerage passengers were allowed on the upper deck. And she told me how they cheered, cried, waved, danced, all the emotions. I used to like to hear her tell that story when I was a kid. So that has that personal meaning for me, yeah.
That was your maternal grandmother?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Was your father also from Ireland?
No, he was born in Rochester, New York. And he liked to play a joke on gas station attendants. Now, I had the same name as my father, Gregory Peck. He had the same name as I. So he'd fill up his car with gas and he'd hand over his car. Now this one, he was a white-haired gentleman, bushy black eyebrows, about 76, 77 years old. He'd hand them the car, they said, Gregory Peck. And they'd look inside the car and they'd say, you're Gregory Peck? He'd say, ah, yes, but you see, I've not been at all well lately. And he loved to do that. He was full of jokes. He was a real Irishman.
Mr. Peck, there's been some criticism that the ceremonies tonight might be too much glitz or too commercial and maybe not solemn enough for the occasion.
Well, glitzy, I don't know, but I'm certainly glad it's not going to be solemn. I don't think any of us are going to forget what that great lady means over there. And none of us forget the words of Emma Lazarus. But this is the American way. When we have political inventions, we wear crazy hats. When we have entertainment between the halves of a football game, we have girls dancing, we have sex appeal, we have clowning about, we have marching bands. We have a good time about it. So it's a significant day and a great day, the 100th anniversary of the great lady there. But we're going to have fun in our own American way. And a little hullabaloo and a little glitz and a little horn blowing doesn't do any harm, I don't think.
Well, we'll be looking forward to seeing you later and very shortly as you introduce President Mitterrand. Good luck tonight.
Thank you, Barbara.
Boy, Gregory Peck puts his fingers on so many things. There's nowhere else in the world, I suspect, where this kind of celebration, which has such deep and profound meaning, is going to have as much hoopla attached to it. Some call it glitz, some call it glitter. We certainly hope, whether you're at home or coming to the neighborhood, that it's going to be fun. Let's talk for a moment about that other famous island, Liberty Island, which used to be Bedloe's Island, where the statue now stands, is of course the absolute epicenter of this particular harbor. But over there, of course, is Ellis Island, through which 40% of Americans today had their ancestors come. What a connection to one small island, sometimes called the Tears, the Isle of Tears. The bulk of the Russian immigrants to this country came here between 1880 and 1920. And tonight, when approximately 300 people are sworn in publicly on television all across the country from Ellis Island, one clearly of the most visible will be a Russian dancer and choreographer named Mikhail Baryshnikov. And later this evening, he'll dance for us. First, here's Stone Phillips.
An immigrant flees an oppressive government to find freedom in America, becomes a movie star, a darling of society, a manager, an entrepreneur. A turn-of-the-century tale? No, a success story of the 80s. The story of Mikhail Baryshnikov. Born in Latvia in the Soviet Union in 1948, as a teenager, he entered Leningrad's famed Kirov Ballet Company and was instantly acclaimed when he made his first solo performance in 1962. In 1970, he began performing in the West. 4 years later, he made a momentous decision.
And I didn't plan my defection in 1974. It was just a necessity, an urge. And it was a one-day decision.
Defecting to the West in Toronto that day in 1974 was not, he maintains, a political act, but a search for artistic freedom. For Baryshnikov, ballet was only a launching pad. Dancing on film, the turning point, his screen debut in 1977 earned him an Oscar nomination. He greeted presidents and paid tribute to some of his American idols.
I have been invited to say something about how dancers feel about Fred Astaire. It's no secret, we hate him.
That's life.
That's life.
That's what all the people say.
And before long, Mikhail Baryshnikov had become not just a beloved ballet dancer, but a media superstar, with television specials that were more showbiz than Swan Lake, and an acquired poise at handling the ever-present press. His latest film, White Nights, was a critical and box office success, showcasing Baryshnikov as one of show business's hottest properties. He's even branched out into hot properties of his own, part ownership in a restaurant on Manhattan's trendy Upper West Side.
I'm definitely American now. I'm pretty fast. I'm pretty cynical. But I love it.
But not too cynical. The ballet dancer who came here looking for artistic freedom 12 years ago is today artistic director of the American Ballet Theater.
Well, here tonight on Ellis Island, as you can see, the speeches are just about to begin. And with the actual swearing-in ceremony just about an hour away, there's a tremendous feeling of anticipation here. As Peter said earlier, what's actually happening is that Ellis Island tonight becomes a federal court so that these immigrants can become full-fledged Americans, among them, of course, Baryshnikov. But he's really only one of 300 here on Ellis Island and one of several thousand across the country who will take the oath of citizenship tonight. This group includes two petitioners from every state and the District of Columbia and every U.S. territory. They were handpicked by their respective governors. And to look at them is to see an incredible mosaic of different cultural and religious backgrounds. Finally, what you're really going to see here tonight, amidst all of the hoopla and fanfare of Liberty Weekend, is a simple and solemn ceremony. Chief Justice Burger will take to the stage. He'll ask the petitioners to raise their right hands, renounce loyalty to any foreign government, and pledge their allegiance to the United States. And with that, their common aspirations of citizenship here will come true. One final note, Peter. Before they took their seats here, the petitioners were treated to an all-American snack. You can almost guess what was on the menu. It was Coca-Cola and a slice of apple pie.
Thanks very much, Stone. Simple, but certainly not private. As you know, that ceremony is going to be part of the opening ceremonies, and we must tell you that a couple of judges, one in Los Angeles and one in Washington, didn't want to participate today because they thought that all of the hoopla attached to the swearing-in of new immigrants to become new citizens in the glare of publicity would just simply not make it a dignified occasion. But there is that picture there, Barbara, of that man sitting holding the Statue of Liberty in his lap. I don't think there could be anything more dignified than that.
And every time we look at that Statue of Liberty, there it is behind us. What a beautiful sight. We're going to come back and talk more about that and tell you more about what you're going to be seeing tonight. We will be back in just a moment.
To see the Statue of Liberty, as you will over the next 4 days, from so many angles and so many different lights, there in the foreground of your picture, the Battery Park in Manhattan, among the hundreds of thousands of people who will come over Liberty Weekend, and they're one of the tour boats, hesitant at the moment because the U.S. Coast Guard has closed off the channel now between the Statue of Liberty and where we are on Governor's Island, as President Reagan and President Mitterrand of France are about to come and join the opening ceremony.
Ladies and gentlemen,
there is another lady who shares the history of the Statue of Liberty, although she certainly didn't know that that would happen. Her name is Emma Lazarus, and it's her words that are inscribed on a tablet inside the Statue of Liberty. Sandra Van Oker tells us more about this lady.
Her poem graces one of the world's most familiar symbols of freedom, the Statue of Liberty. It captures an era in our nation's history that few writers or poets have equaled. The words belong to Emma Lazarus. The voice is Charlton Heston's.
Here at the sea-washed sunset gates shall stand a mighty woman with a torch, whose flame is the imprisoned lightning, and her name, Mother of Exiles.
Emma Lazarus wrote that poem, The New Colossus, in 1883, 3 years before the statue's unveiling. She wrote it for a fundraising auction at New York's Academy of Music to help raise money for the statue's pedestal, the pedestal where her famous words now reside. The poem, by the way, sold for $1,500. She was born in New York in 1884 to a wealthy and prominent Jewish family. The daughter of a successful industrialist, she led an isolated life, a stranger to the hardships of the millions of immigrants that flooded through New York Harbor. "I always will be loyal to my race," she once wrote, "but I feel no religious fervor in my soul." It was the mass of Jewish refugees fleeing the pogroms of Russia that historians say swelled her consciousness as a Jew. She and her poetry were transformed. Her words spoke to the tens of millions of immigrants of every race and nationality that came to America with hopes of a better life.
"Keep ancient lands, your storied pomp, cries she with silent lips. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed, to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door.
Emma Lazarus would never know the importance that her poem holds or the spirit that her words symbolize. Her poem was not placed at the base of the Statue of Liberty until almost 20 years after her death. But to this day, it still stands as a tribute to her and to the idea of liberty. The first light that Emma Lazarus's huddled masses saw was not the Statue of Liberty. It was a light similar to this one on a Coast Guard lightship, like this one, which is the Nantucket Second, which was retired in 1984 after serving for many years on Nantucket Shoals, about 100 miles to the north-northeast of here. The lightship was the first glimmer of liberty they saw. The second was the Ambrose lightship off New York Harbor, and then they saw the Statue of Liberty. Those lamps are now gone, but the Statue of Liberty will be lit tonight. Barbara?
Thank you, Sander. A perfectly beautiful shot of a fireboat in New York Harbor, and later tonight you'll hear horns from all the boats as the lights go on and the President unveils the Statue of Liberty and lights its torch. He will also be presenting medals of liberty, and it's almost about to begin. The audience is quiet and expectant.
Almost as if, Barbara, I think they understand, as we certainly do, that people are here to celebrate an idea, not just an event. I was thinking just a little while ago about Auguste Bartholdi. He is the Frenchman who designed and sculpted the Statue of Liberty. And when he set out for the New World in 1871 to New York Harbor, he was looking for a place, that island as it turns out, on which to set his contribution to friendship between France and the United States and peace of admiration for the New World. Now, we know in this day and age, all of you across the country are not so kindly disposed to New York as we'd like you to be this evening. But remember what Auguste Bartholdi wrote in 1871. It is indeed the New World. And when I landed here, I knew it was the idea that my friends in Europe had told me about. We're looking forward to the opening ceremonies. We hope you'll stay with us. I'm Peter Jennings for Barbara Walters. We hope you have a good evening.
Ladies and gentlemen, to conduct the Liberty Orchestra in his composition, Liberty Fanfare, written especially for this occasion, Mr. John Williams. Ladies and gentlemen, from Governor's Island in New York Harbor, to all the people of the world, welcome to the opening ceremonies of Liberty Weekend.
John Williams, the conductor of the Boston Pops, the conductor for this evening as this
Opening ceremonies begin here on the shores of New York Harbor.
The President of the French Republic and Madame Francois Mitterrand.
President Mitterrand, elected as the President of France in 1981 for a 7-year term, who comes here to share the honors of the spotlight with President Reagan this Liberty weekend for many reasons. Because French-American history goes back to the Revolutionary War, French assistance, because it was France which gave the Statue of Liberty to this country 100 years ago tomorrow, and because President Mitterrand and President Reagan have business to discuss, which they will do tomorrow, after they have reviewed together the International Naval Armada. Ruffles and flourishes.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States and Mrs. Reagan.
Reagan. the president who has done so much to give the United States the measure of spirit which it presently has about itself, and who tomorrow will come down the Hudson River on board the USS Iowa to review the ships of the 21 nations who've come here to pay tribute to the United States and to the Statue of Liberty. Going to the presidential box where, on a number of occasions this evening, he shall be the center of the spotlight. And here in what we might call Liberty Stadium for this evening, the crowd on its feet.
The French Republic Band play the National Anthem of the Republic of France.
The Marseillaise.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, the national anthem of the United States of America, sung by a participant of the very special art program, Kenneth Mack Jr.
Machita, Louisiana. The Very Special Arts Program is an international organization which provides art programs for the disabled. Last year, this child sang at both the White House and the Vatican. We'll be right back.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Gregory Peck.
Thank you. Mr. President, Mrs. Reagan, President Mitterrand, Madame Mitterrand, honored guests and fellow Americans, this ceremony of rededication and restoration will hopefully have a profound effect on the collective conscience of people everywhere, for it underscores one of the deepest yearnings of all mankind, the right of all men to find individual freedom in a free society. In a world where time is measured in milliseconds, 100 years of longevity in any area is worthy of recognition. But this event, marking a century of real and symbolic friendship between our two nations, gives us even greater cause for celebration. Not only does it acknowledge our mutual love of traditional values, but in the larger sense, it represents a priceless gift, a gift of dreams made tangible and visible through a monument dedicated to freedom and liberty. This copper-clad colossus standing in the harbor with upraised torch and crown of light was for millions their first glimpse of America. For millions of others entering this promised land from other directions, the image of liberty enlightening the world was a vision they carried deep within their hearts. As with many other great visions, the Statue of Liberty could be said to have had its birth as the result of a death. In 1865, the assassination of President Lincoln shocked the world. In France, the gifted sculptor, Frédéric Auguste Bartholdi, felt compelled to express his countrymen's deep affection for America with a dramatic gesture. On his first visit here, Providence led him to an abandoned fort in New York Harbor called Bedloe's Island. It was the ideal site for the monumental statue he was planning. In this sketch, done at the time, he named her Liberty Enlightening the World, the lady's torch and radiant crown lighting the way for all who yearn to enter the land of freedom. Returning to France, he soon found the inspiration for the statue's face, his mother. It took 3 years, however, for Bartholdi to complete his design. Construction began in 1876, with funds donated entirely by the French people. Plaster molds of some 300 sections were made to Bartholdi's amazingly accurate specifications. Then copper sheeting was hammered into wooden forms. The entire statue would be comprised of a copper shell, a mere 3/32 of an inch thick. To encourage continued support for this long-term and expensive project, sections were then put on public display. Gustav Eiffel, the brilliant engineer who would soon build his famous tower, was called on to design the statue's iron framework. The virtually hollow structure rose 15 stories, weighed 225 tons, and was ingeniously engineered to withstand winds of 100 miles an hour. In 1884, after 8 years of dedicated effort and a cost of $250,000, the statue was finally completed in Paris. In New York, however, construction of its mammoth pedestal had not yet begun. Only its cornerstone had been set in place. When the statue arrived in New York a year later, packed in 200 crates, the base had not been finished. American donations for completing the work had run out. It was then that Joseph Pulitzer, the newspaper magnate and an immigrant himself, organized a campaign to raise the last $100,000. It would come in pennies, nickels, and dimes, much of it from children. But come it did, and the statue finally gained her foothold in the New World. On a rainy day in 1886, this remarkable gift from the people of France was officially presented to the people of the United States, and a new symbol of hope was given to the world. add even greater import to this historic celebration, I'm proud to introduce the President of the Republic of France, François Mitterrand.
President Mitterrand being played onto the stage here on the edge of New York Harbor by his own Garde Républicaine band, the band of the Garde République. President Mitterrand, of course, is going to have some fairly serious conversations while he's here with President Reagan. And then, perhaps by coincidence, will fly on Monday to Moscow, where he will see the General Secretary, Mikhail Gorbachev. It is not unlikely that he shall speak in French. He speaks some English.
Messager du peuple français. J'apporte
as a messenger from the French people,
américain.
I bring to the American people
le salut fraternel,
the fraternal greetings
mon pays, la France.
Of my country, France.
Il y a deux siècles.
Two centuries ago,
la France était à vos côtés
France
pour la
was at your side
votre indépendance.
When you won your independence.
Il y a cent ans,
100 years ago,
des milliers et des milliers
thousands upon
de
thousands
France
of the sons and daughters of France
offraient aux États-Unis d'Amérique
presented the United States of America
statue,
with
la statue
this statue
de la liberté,
of liberty.
Symbole
today,
aujourd'hui
the
de
symbol
la première
of the foremost
de nos valeurs communes.
Of our common values.
À votre tour,
you,
vous êtes venu
in your turn,
deux fois,
came twice
au prix de votre sang,
at the cost of your own blood
nous aider
to help us
et notre
to save our independence
et notre liberté.
And our freedom.
Telle est l'histoire qu'ensemble
such is the history
nous avons faite.
We have made together.
Telle est l'histoire qu'ensemble
and such is the history
nous allons faire.
We are going to make together.
Puisse les enfants de
may
nos enfants
our children's children
se retrouver
meet
pour
again
célébrer toujours ensemble dans 100 ans
another 100 years from now
plus longtemps
and
encore,
long thereafter
la fête des
to celebrate still together the festival of free people in a world at peace.
Il n'y aura pas de repos d'ici là.
In the meantime, there will be no respite for those who believe that life is not
si
worth living unless the very air breathes forth for individuals and nations the simple right
libre.
To live in freedom.
J'exprime au président
may
et à Madame
I convey to President Reagan and Mrs. Reagan the feelings which the French nation has for them. As well as the pride which I feel at this time as spokesman for a friendship which is stronger than the tests of time. Finally, to all you Americans who are listening to me, I say with all the strength of my heart and my mind,
Happy birthday, United States! Happy birthday, Miss Liberty.
As we said, President Mitterrand speaks a little English, but it is as much as anything a political statement. No matter how kindly disposed French presidents are to America, in their own homeland, it is considered de rigueur as a French say to speak French, not English. We'll be right back.
Exclusive coverage of Liberty Weekend will continue.
Gentlemen, Mr. Kenny Rogers.
Thank you. The United States and France have had a special relationship that dates back to our Revolutionary War. What American child hasn't heard of General Lafayette and the role he played in helping our country obtain its freedom? And what French child hasn't been made aware of the American soldiers who fought and died in the soil of France to preserve that precious commodity called liberty during two world wars? We gather here this evening to pay homage to that remarkable friendship that is so gloriously represented by the statue that stands out in the harbor. At the original dedication ceremonies held 100 years ago, President Grover Cleveland said, "We will not forget that liberty has made here her home, nor shall her chosen altar be neglected. A stream of light shall pierce the darkness of ignorance and man's oppression until liberty enlightens the world." And Edward de La Bellay, the French senator and scholar who first conceived the idea for the Statue of Liberty, wrote these words over a century ago. "This Statue of Liberty will preserve among future generations, like a sacred tradition, the eternal friendship of the United States and France." And now it is my pleasure to introduce one of France's outstanding entertainers, who will be joined by a gentleman whose voice has been deemed by President Reagan to be a national treasure. Together they will sing a musical tribute to the vision and the ideals that made the Statue of Liberty possible. Please welcome Mireille Mathieu and Andy Williams.
Stood side by side and hand in hand.
La liberté sur l'Atlantique.
Now we can see how far we've come.
Défie le temps.
And where we stand.
C'était un cadeau de Marianne.
100 years ago she came.
La statue Bartin d'Eiffel.
A gift of love to shine her light.
Au cœur du monde.
A light of hope. Oh,
If the Statue of Liberty was the light of hope for millions of immigrants, then Ellis Island was the door of hope. It was the last barrier to entrance into the United States and the first step on the road to citizenship. On Ellis Island, which is undergoing a major refurbishing right now, is a man who would like to tell us more about this historic place. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Robert De Niro.
This is Ellis Island, a very precious piece of real estate, and this is my son, Raphael, a very important part of my life. I'm very happy to be at this historical place at this jubilant time with this particular person because I believe we are all destined to remember this moment for years to come. Every parent wants to pass on to his children the things he believes are important, and what could be more important than being a part of history? A century ago, the Statue of Liberty became the symbol of welcome to immigrants arriving in New York Harbor after a long, hard journey. But they were now coming in such vast numbers that an obstacle to their final landing was created to control the human tidal wave. Called Ellis Island, it would serve as processing center for all those crammed into steerage. Yet the delay couldn't diminish their excitement, their joyous anticipation. They had come too far, had suffered too much poverty or persecution in their homelands to let this formality dampen their desire to forge a better life. Between 1892 and 1954, nearly 17 million men, women, and children passed through Ellis Island. In 1907, a record year, overworked officials processed 3,000 people a day. Despite the speed of the procedures during this tumultuous period, there was just reason for fear and doubt among the stateless foreigners. A prevalent eye disease, trachoma, or tuberculosis, or mental illness, if detected, was cause for detention and possible deportation. Remarkably, this fate befell only a small percent of those who entered Ellis Island. Age-old family names, if found unpronounceable by the American registrar, would be changed. But the worst was over. A railroad ticket office was provided for those who had hope of a job or relatives to join beyond New York. So now the moment drew near when these immigrants from Ireland, from Hungary, Italy, Greece, from virtually every European nation and the Caribbean as well, would be ferried back to Manhattan, their new lives soon to begin. These faces should seem familiar, for they are the faces of the parents, grandparents, and great-grandparents of many of us who are looking at them now. Proud, honest, good faces. The faces of our past, present, and future. The human drama of Ellis Island ended 3 decades ago, but it remains an indelible, haunting part of our heritage. One of the reasons today is so special is because Ellis Island is about to be reborn, if only for a brief moment in time. People have gathered here, as they have in 44 other cities, to prepare for one of the most meaningful moments of their lives. They come to take the oath of citizenship that will make them full-fledged Americans. They are representative of millions who came before them, and each has a story to tell about why and how he came to this moment in time. Some were fleeing from oppression. Some were joining their relatives who were fortunate enough to have arrived earlier. Some came looking for gainful employment, shoemakers and farmers and tailors seeking to ply their trade in an atmosphere of opportunity and respect. And some came with the respect of the world already in their possession, but with a burning desire to dance to a different drummer, to a beat that allowed for growth and freedom of expression. They all harbored dreams of a better life, and sometimes the dreams came true.
The Honorable the Chief Justice of the United States. Oh yay, oh yay, oh yay. All persons having business before the Honorable, the Chief Justice of the United States, are admonished to draw near and give their attention. God save the United States and this honorable court.
The court recognizes the Attorney General of the United States. Mr. Attorney General.
Mr. Chief Justice, may it please the court, I stand before you tonight on the eve of the celebration of the 100th anniversary of the Statue of Liberty, our most famous symbol of the hopes and aspirations of millions of people who have chosen to make the United States their home. Many of America's most honorable men and women have passed before this aisle in pursuit of freedom on our shores. As loyal citizens, they have served this country with distinction. I am confident that the petitioners gathered here and in courtrooms throughout the country will follow admirably in their footsteps. All of the petitioners have met the statutory requirements for citizenship. They are all persons of good moral character and have agreed to uphold the principles of our Constitution and our form of government. Mr. Chief Justice, I therefore recommend that the oath of citizenship be administered to these petitioners.
Your motion is granted, Mr. Attorney General. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, today's ceremony has a very special meaning for me, and one that I share with all of you and with millions of others. My grandfather, whose name I bear, came to these shores about 145 years ago, as millions had done before and have done since. His father was an Austrian, his mother was Swiss. After they settled in the Middle West, a plague left him an orphan at about age 10. In 1861, he joined the Union Army, and his service during that war earned him the Congressional Medal of Honor, the highest military honor our country can bestow. A century and a half later, his descendants manifest why we are rightly called a nation of immigrants. Mrs. Berger and I have two grandchildren who are a mixture of Austrian, Swiss, German, Swedish, English, and Scots. Today we celebrate this great symbol of freedom given to us by the people of France, the people who helped us gain our freedom. That great Lady of Liberty faces not west to our land, but out to the seas as a welcome to those who seek our kind of freedom. Our Constitution is a unique, remarkable instrument. And 200 years ago, it operated to unleash the latent talents and energies and the abilities of every individual who came here, so that each person could develop according to his or her God-given gifts. People were meant to be free, and the great statue that we rededicate today symbolizes not only our freedom, but also the Constitution that guarantees those freedoms and has guaranteed those freedoms for 200 years. It is a symbol not just to the American people, it is a symbol to the people everywhere who want freedom under a system of liberty with order. Now, it is my honor and privilege to ask each of you who seek citizenship to raise your right hand and on this Bible repeat after me. I hereby declare on oath that I renounce all allegiance and fidelity to any foreign prince or potentate or state or sovereignty of which I have heretofore been a subject or citizen, that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States and the laws of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, and that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same, that I will bear arms on behalf of the United States when required by law, that I will perform non-combat service in the armed forces of the United States when required by law, that I will perform work of a national importance when required by law, that I take this obligation freely, without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion. So help me God. Now, my fellow citizens, I congratulate you and ask all present here and in the other ceremonies taking place in the United States to recite with me the Pledge of Allegiance, which is as follows. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The Honorable Court is now adjourned.
Mark, America's Costantino, to return to the podium to close out tonight's ceremony.
Four locations across the country, as Chief Justice Burger said, thousands of new American citizens as America opens its arms. Once again, almost one of his last official acts as Chief Justice. He will soon retire to chair the commission to celebrate the bicentennial of the Constitution. We'll be right back.
ABC's presentation of Liberty Weekend is brought...
Ladies and gentlemen, the chairman and executive producer of Liberty Weekend, Mr. David Wolper.
Thank you. It is my pleasure to welcome you all to Liberty Weekend. During the course of the next few days, we will try to impart some sense of the profound and pleasant meaning this statue has for countless American and freedom-loving people everywhere. If we succeed in our task, it will be due in no small part to the volunteers and staff of Liberty Weekend, whose generosity of spirit and talent surpassed our fondest hopes. My gratitude to them is matched by my admiration for their enthusiasm and devotion. We hope you will all enjoy Liberty Weekend and participate in all the events that we have planned. Although it's been a tough road to travel at times, getting here this day has made it all worthwhile. Now I have the honor to introduce to you a man who heads the branch of government responsible for keeping the Statue of Liberty as bright and meaningful as she is tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, the Secretary of the Interior, the Honorable Donald Hodel.
Donald Hodel, the Secretary of the Interior, following David Walper, who has had quite a lot to contend with over this week and has stood up well under it all.
Mr. President and my fellow Americans, welcome to the restored Statue of Liberty, the symbol of freedom and hope for all mankind. The statue has particular relevance to the many immigrants whose first glimpse of America was the sight of that towering cathedral to liberty, that monument to hope. But she is treasured by all Americans. We will preserve our God-given liberty for future generations by remaining strong as a nation, by making plain our determination never to let our freedom slip away, and by being an effective ally to those who seek freedom's blessings. We honor our liberty by preserving its symbols, such as the statue. Under your leadership, Mr. President, there is a renewed sense of pride in America. Lady Liberty no longer is confined to her island, but instead every day her silhouette and her spirit enter our homes and our lives. As a result, the people of America made this private sector, non-governmental restoration effort successful. I want to pay special tribute to Lee Iacocca. He brought to the Statue of Liberty Ellis Island Foundation a profound personal commitment. Millions of Americans responded by providing the financial support necessary to enable the Torch of Liberty to continue to enlighten the world. Lee, the American people join me in expressing our gratitude. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce the chairman of the Statue of Liberty Ellis Island Foundation, Lee Iacocca.
Lee Iacocca, something of a folk hero to a great many Americans as a result of his participation in this. We should also tell you in fairness that Secretary Hodel, who just paid tribute, fired him from the Centennial Commission some months ago.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Well, tonight concludes a four-year labor of love. 4 years ago, President Reagan wisely chose to place the job of saving America's most sacred symbol in the hands of the American people themselves. And the people responded from their hearts and from their pocketbooks. I'm proud to announce that just in time for this celebration tonight, we have surpassed our goal of $265 million. Now, that's a huge number for a private fundraising effort. But more important than how much is from whom. And the answer to that is from everybody. From millionaires and school kids, from companies and civic groups, from people in Europe, and from people behind the Iron Curtain, even from Vietnamese boat people. It came $5 million at a time, and it came 5 cents at a time. To all of you, from all the people who worked on this great project, we say thank you. And now tonight, we pay you back. We relight the torch, but we do more than that. We also restore the flame of liberty. We remember the millions drawn here by that flame, and we renew our commitment to the ideals that kept it burning. It is fitting that the man who will unveil the statue is a man who has contributed so much to the rebirth of the spirit of patriotism in America. He made it fashionable to be a patriot again, and he set the tone for what we do here tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my high privilege and honor to introduce the President of the United States and Mrs. Reagan.
A standing ovation from the audience as the president gets ready to give us the highlight of the evening, the unveiling of the statue.
We should tell people, Barbara, there are really two moments like this in the evening. The president at this point, along with Mrs. Reagan, will unveil the Statue of Liberty again in a formal way. Later on, he will light the torch.
Thank you, and Lee Iacocca, thank you on behalf of all of America. President and Madam Mitterrand, my fellow Americans, the iron workers from New York and New Jersey who came here to begin restoration work were at first puzzled and a bit put off to see foreign workers, craftsmen from France, arrive. John Weyar, the leader of the French workers, said his countrymen understood. After all, he asked, how would Frenchmen feel if Americans showed up to help restore the Eiffel Tower? But as they came to know each other, these Frenchmen and Americans, affections grew, and so too did perspectives. The Americans were reminded that Miss Liberty, like the many millions she's welcomed to these shores, is a foreign birth, the gift of workers, farmers and shopkeepers and children who donated hundreds of thousands of francs to send her here. They were the ordinary people of France. This statue came from their pockets and from their hearts. The French workers, too, made discoveries. Monsieur Weyar, for example, normally lives in a 150-year-old cottage in a small French town. But for the last year, he's been riding the subway through Brooklyn. A study in contrasts, he said. Contrast indeed. But he has also told the newspapers that he and his countrymen learned something else at Liberty Island. For the first time, they worked in proximity with Americans of Jewish, Black, Italian, Irish, Russian, Polish, and Indian backgrounds. Fascinating, he said, to see different ethnic and national types work and live so well together. But it's how we like to think of America. And it's good to know that Miss Liberty is still giving life to the dream of a new world where old antagonisms could be cast aside and people of every nation could live together as one. It's especially fitting that this lesson should be relived and relearned here by Americans and Frenchmen. President Mitterrand, the French and American people have forged a special friendship over the course of two centuries. Yes, in the 1700s, France was the midwife of our liberty. In two world wars, America stood with France as she fought for her life and for civilization. And today, Mr. President, with infinite gentleness, your countrymen tend the final resting places, marked now by rows of white crosses and stars, of more than 60,000 Americans who remain on French soil. A reminder since the days of Lafayette of our mutual struggles and sacrifices for freedom. So tonight, as we celebrate the friendship of our two nations, we also pray, may it ever be so. God bless America and vive la France. And yet, my fellow Americans, it is not only the friendship of two peoples, but the friendship of all peoples that brings us here tonight. We celebrate something more than the restoration of this statue's physical grandeur. Another worker here, Scott Aronson, a marble restorer, has put it well. I grew up in Brooklyn and never went to the Statue of Liberty. But when I first walked in there to work, I thought about my grandfathers coming through here. And which of us does not think of other grandfathers and grandmothers from so many places around the globe for whom this statue was the first glimpse of America? She was silhouetted very clear. One of them wrote about standing on deck as their ship entered New York Harbor. We passed her very slowly. Of course, we had to look up. She was beautiful. Another talked of how all the passengers rushed to one side of the boat for a fast look at their new home. And at her Everybody was crying. The whole boat bent toward her. She was beautiful with the early morning light. To millions returning home, especially from foreign wars, she was also special. A young World War captain of artillery described how on a troop ship returning from France, even the most hard-bitten veteran had trouble blinking back the tears. I've never seen anything that looked so good, that doughboy, Harry Truman, wrote to his fiancée, Bess, back in Independence, Missouri, as the Liberty Lady in New York Harbor. And that's why tonight we celebrate this mother of exiles who lifts her light beside the Golden Door. Many of us have seen the picture of another worker here, iron or tool belt around his waist, balanced on a narrow metal rod of scaffolding, leaning over to place a kiss on the forehead of Miss Liberty. Tony Cerassi, the grandson of immigrant Italians, said it was something he was proud to do, something to tell my grandchildren. Robert Kearney feels the same way. At work on the statue after a serious illness, he gave $10,000 worth of commemorative pins to those who visited here. Part of the reason, he says, was an earlier construction job over in Hoboken and his friend named Blackie. They could see the harbor from the building where they were working on. And every morning, Blackie would look over the water, give a salute, and say, "That's my gal." Well, the truth is, she's everybody's gal. We sometimes forget that even those who came here first to settle the new land were also strangers. I've spoken before of the tiny Arabella, a ship at anchor just off the Massachusetts coast, a little group of Puritans huddled on the deck. And then John Winthrop, who would later become the first governor of Massachusetts, reminded his fellow Puritans there on that tiny deck that they must keep faith with their God, that the eyes of all the world were upon them, and that they must not forsake the mission that God had sent them on, and they must be a light unto the nations of all the world, a shining city upon a hill. Call it mysticism, if you will. I have always believed there was some divine providence that placed this great land here between the two great oceans to be found by a special kind of people from every corner of the world who had a special love for freedom and a special courage that enabled them to leave their own land, leave their friends and their countrymen, and come to this new and strange land to build a new world of peace and freedom and hope. Lincoln spoke about hope as he left the hometown he would never see again to take up the duties of the presidency and bring America through a terrible civil war. At each stop on his long train ride to Washington, the news grew worse. The nation was dividing. His own life was in peril. On he pushed, undaunted. In Philadelphia, he spoke in Independence Hall, where 85 years earlier, the Declaration of Independence had been signed. He noted that much more had been achieved there than just independence from Great Britain. It was, he said, hope to the world, future for all time. Well, that is the common thread that binds us to those Quakers on the tiny deck of the Arabella, to the beleaguered farmers and landowners signing the Declaration in Philadelphia, in that hot Philadelphia hall, to Lincoln on a train, ready to guide us people through the conflagration, to all the millions crowded in the steerage who passed this lady and wept at the sight of her, and those who've worked here in the scaffolding with their hands and with their love. Jean Weyar, Scott Aronson, Tony Cerassi, Robert Kearney, and so many others. We're bound together because, like them, we too dare to hope. Hope that our children will always find here the land of liberty, in a land that is free. We dare to hope, too, that we'll understand our work can never be truly done until every man, woman, and child shares in our gift, in our hope, and stands with us in the light of liberty, a light that tonight will surely cast its glow upon her, as it has upon us for two centuries, keeping faith with a dream of long ago, and guiding millions still to a future of peace and freedom. And now we will unveil that gallant lady. Thank you, and God bless you all. Nancy?
New York Harbor, people on their feet, clearly agreeing with President Truman, who wrote to his wife, "I've never seen anything that looked so good." Symbol of a nation, symbol of an idea. That is the unveiling of the Statue of Liberty, and later this evening, President Reagan will return to the podium to light the torch. Already know this, President Reagan has just unveiled, with the touch of a button which sent a laser beam across New York Harbor, unveiled the Statue of Liberty, 100 years since she was given to the United States as a gift to France. Here and around the country, America has welcomed many more thousands of new citizens. I'll be back. Just more to come this evening. President Reagan, a little later on, will be actually lighting the torch of Liberty, which looks out to the rest of the world from New York Harbor. We hope you'll stay with us. I'm Peter Jennings.